Okay, welcome back to JoffeyWoodwinds.com. It's been almost several years now since we've had a video interview. And with the pandemic, of course, we've all become accustomed to working and using Zoom. And that's opened up a great deal of opportunity for many of us. And I thought I would take advantage of that in meeting with and interviewing some of our great players who are not necessarily New York based anymore, both people in this country and in other countries. And I'm delighted that the first video interview I'm doing in these since the pandemic is with one of the greatest musicians this country has produced, one of the greatest saxophone players without argument who's ever lived. And it's our pleasure to spend time today with George Young, who's out in California. And George, thank you so much for agreeing to do this. And I can't wait to grill you with the questions and find out more about you and your career, and hopefully information for a lot of players out there, and especially young players who could use your guidance. So welcome. Thank you, George.
Well, thank you for having me, Ed. It's an honor to be here on your stunning series of woodwinders, so to speak.
Yeah, right.
For lack of a better word. I mean, really, you're doing a tremendous job for our instruments, you know, and I really am honored, like I say, to be a part of it.
Well, thank you. And, you know, it's for me, it's like a kid going into a candy store. It's, you know, having a chance to talk with people who I've known or who I've admired, and a chance to get a better understanding of them. And I felt over these last, I think, 6 years that I've been doing these interviews that I've learned from every single interview and been inspired by it. And from what I gather, many other people as well. So really, it's my honor to spend time with you. And so I guess, you know, people in the industry, musicians, and certainly woodwind players who've been around for a while all know about you. And the text that's going to accompany this video is going to have a great deal about your career, as well as reference to your website, which is very complete and gives a great deal of information about what you have done and what you are doing. But, you know, just looking briefly for those who are first meeting you now, George was a mainstay of the New York studio scene for decades. And before that was really quite well known as a rising star, a real virtuoso saxophonist and woodwind doubler. Over the course of George's career, he's made so many films. I think I've counted 52 films, and I'm sure it's not correct that there are more, 455 record dates, hundreds of jingles, concerts, club work, TV work. You've been a leader, you've been a sideman. I mean, I think I'll leave the website to cover all of it, because we could spend the next hour just listing your credits, George. But more importantly, let's get into your career and how it's evolved. And you grew up in Philadelphia, and from what I understand, you started with clarinet at the age of 6. Is that correct?
No, I started with the sax. Actually, I started with the ocarina, the tonette. When I was very young, like, let's go to the beginning.
Yeah.
3-4 years, you know, very early age, there was no TV. You know, I'm right. Old, let's face it. going back to the 40s, Dad uh-huh. would come home from work. He was a factory worker.
Right.
He would bring home these little toys, which were little instruments, ocarinas, tonettes. Sure. Slide whistles, you know,
right,
or penny whistles, as they also are called. But anyway, we would, after dinner, he would be so tired, we would cuddle on the floor and listen to, like, the Lone Ranger and the Green Hornet, And sure. I picked up by ear these songs, the, you know, like Rossini and, you know, the melodies, and I would, you know, figure them out.
Right.
Just by ear on these instruments. Right. And when we'd go over to Uncle Andy's house, he'd say, play the Lone Ranger.
Yeah,
play the Green Hornet, you know? And it was hysterical because I, of course, was always embarrassed. I never, until this day, I'm not that cat. I'm not the person, here I am. I'm not a here I am guy, you know? So, and that goes back to when I was a child, because perhaps Dad used to push it so hard, but he was ever so proud of me. And then as I broke into his alto one day.
Oh, your dad played?
Oh yeah, he played. It got a gorgeous sound.
Ah.
He knew what music was.
I see.
You know, with all capitals, all large case. And
right.
He would, you know, to jump over how I got into playing on his instrument, I was scuffling. The day the war ended, he came home from work, and I got home earlier because of the public school system was declared a big holiday, you know.
Sure.
So I just flocked home, and I was like a detective. I like to root around and see what I could get into. It's something new, you know.
Yeah, right.
Like lots of kids.
Yeah, right.
I remembered he always parked the alto in its case underneath his bed. And my mother used to chase him up into, you know, get out of here, you're giving me a headache with that thing. You know, he would try to woo her with its June and January and all the pop songs of that era, just, you know, just singing them out on his instrument. And I found it quite fascinating. And he opted to use the bathroom because of the tile and the acoustics it provided. I sat on the edge of the bathtub. He'd close the commode and use the towel rack as a music stand. So I'm checking this all out. So the day that the war ended and I got home, I delve into his horn, put it together like I had seen him do so many times. And I started to go at it, squawking and squeaking away, frustrated. And the door of the bathroom opens, and it's my father. And I figured, oh, he's often threatened to strap, you know, many times for bad conduct. And I figured, oh, this is going to do it. You know, I'm finally going to get the strap, which I never really did. Instead, he had tears in his eyes. He's looking at me, he's this little brat, you know, broke into my stash. And here right. He is trying to play.
Right.
So he tried to teach me, had no teaching skills. I started studying with a violinist who had a music school, Mr. Uh-huh. Hitchner. And that was the start until he said, I can't teach him anything else.
Right.
Dad used to bring home, I used to do my lessons, you know, the Rubank books.
Sure.
Where it started. And then he would bring home these standards, and he taught me how to transpose. Now they had a family band that would gather on weekends at, my father had five brothers and sisters. I mean, it was a huge family. And they all used, whoever played instruments got around the piano. Uncle Louie would play the piano, and then who didn't play would sing. And it would be songs of the day plus our ethnic folk songs from your Eastern European.
Right.
From Croatia and, Croatia and Czechoslovakia. See, those two. That was the George Ernest Opolisky Jr., hello. Mother's maiden name was Yankura, Yankura. So in searching for a handle for this marquee I was featured on, we came up with the word young. I was a young boy.
I see.
So that hand stayed with me until today.
You know? I see. Okay.
But
you know, I find it interesting, the encouragement, the fact that your father had the instrument in the house, the encouragement, the fact that there was music in the family, all of this positive influence is what is so necessary to motivate any child to get started in any of the arts. And I have to just tell you, my father also played alto. He had an alto in the closet. It was a Büscher. And he took it out from time to time, and I just loved the sound he got. He had studied with Bill Shiner, you know, Stan Getz's old teacher. He grew up in the Bronx, and you know, that type of vibe in those in the 30s. But this, I just loved when he took out the horn and the smell of that horn, the Büscher coming out of the case, and I loved it. And for years, I could never figure out what that smell was until one day I realized it was mothballs.
But the Büscher was a good horn. That's what Dad had, the same thing. It was like
Büscher,
the horn of choice then.
That's right. And the metal was spectacular on those horns. Yep.
Silver with the gold inlay bell.
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, it's that influence of the parent and hearing them play and seeing their enjoyment playing is so important. And I think for music going forward, music education, you know, when kids have a parent that's encouraging in music or that is involved in music, you can't beat that. That's the one thing that has to happen to keep, you know, generations of musicians occurring. And I'm hopeful that somehow that will keep occurring. But, you know, it's not like it was in the mid 20th century, for sure. But it's just interesting. I just had to interrupt there because I saw myself, quite frankly, when you were talking.
There you go. Yeah, that was a golden era for kids, for sure. Kids to pick up on what they were seeing and hearing, you know? Sure. I looked at this thing, it was like a gorgeous piece of jewelry or this pipe that Papa was playing on. And then he would bring home these songs and I would play literally whatever the melody was. And he'd say, no, I want you to play it more musical. I want you to put yourself in it, you know? Don't be an oat pusher, be a musician.
Was your dad formally trained in music or was he just picked it up by ear and just learned to play?
My Uncle Louie,
yeah,
who fathered my cousin Lou Opaleski, who he doesn't play anymore and he really makes me angry. Gorgeous trumpet, he used to make the trumpet sound like flowers, you know, that gorgeous sound. He was the one that told me the softest cats can play the loudest and it'll be beautiful. Whereas you take the loudest guys that are just rough cut with this trumpet and they play fortissimo, you put a piano or mezzo piano up in front of them and they'll fold because the loudest cats can't play soft. And that applies to all instruments.
Yes.
So the softest cats can play louder than anybody. But there's going to be beautiful sound there. It just comes down to two things, you know. It's just about listening and being fussy. What are you hearing? Is it beautiful? Do you know how to play something beautiful instead of like a bunch of fingers and, you know, just pick it up and start, you know, like it's some sort of a baseball bat and it's like or a tennis racket. No, this is an instrument capable of doing many beautiful things. We can always go to the ugly side of things if we need to. We can get loud and harsh and brutal. We could change our mouthpiece.
Put a metal as mouthpiece. We do.
Yes. I mean, there's so many things. But not enough. You know, I get students, and you know, I'll tell them, please play softer. A good musician can play in a telephone booth and he can play music. Music is that most important word that has to accompany the player and his instrument, regardless of what it is. You don't just want to be a note pusher. You want to do something. You want to mold the notes into a story because it's a map on the paper. If you're improvising without paper, you do the same thing. You want to tell a story, you know? Less notes and more music is a good theme, you know?
Yeah. And coming from you as a person who has all the technique in the world and could do anything on the horn, and yet this is what is uppermost in your mind about music. And that in itself, I think, I hope, will translate to those who listen to this, especially the younger players, that it's everything to be able to play a melody beautifully. You know, it's interesting in the teaching that I've done over the years, I find fewer and fewer young players, especially in alto sax, talking about Johnny Hodges. Oh. And I try to always bring them back and I say, you know, if you listen to Johnny Hodges once a day when you're playing alto, it just sets you in the right gear and all that. And they look at me a lot of times like I'm crazy. I said, no, because if you can do a Johnny, if you can just play a melody, forget about the solo, just play the melody with the inflections and the beauty that Hodges, it'll put you in a zone, in the right zone to do whatever else you want.
You got to put your heart in it, Ed.
Yeah.
It's got to come from the heart. I mean, mentally and with fingers and stuff, it all plays an important part in the grooming and the growing of the player. But the thing is, once that's all set, or you feel comfortable with your facilities that you've earned, always keeping music in the forefront of what you're doing. If you're playing one note, or if you're playing like a little, like I tell the kids, I say, look, take those exercises and play them like they're songs, bounce them around. You know, you don't have to, you know, it's nice to be in step and do everything like with a metronome and stuff. That's very important. But at the same time, once you feel you really have those connections around the questionable areas, like the break when you're going from D to C sharp on the saxophone, or the break on the clarinet, whatever, once you have listened closely and very discriminately to what you're doing there and render the smoothness that it takes with the repetition, the principle of relentless pressure, the over and over of it, to massage it, then have fun with it, bounce it around, take it out of the regimentation of click, 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 and take those third and then play it in every key. And there you're on your way to building not only facilities on your instrument with fun in mind, but you're honoring the music that's capable of coming out of those silly, basic, boring exercises. Right. Make them fun. That's the one thing with practice that kids have to learn. It can be fun. And if it's fun, you're going to get there quicker.
Right.
And if you're paying attention to music, remembering, and a lot of the kids at first think I'm nuts, music is a living thing. It's listening all the time. And if you do it justice, there will be a reward. There will definitely be a reward. If you turn that phrase with your heart in combination with everything else, all your utilities that you've built up over your practice sessions, having fun, you'll see something will come out of there. You'll be just astounded. Wow. I wish I had that recorded. Well, I have an old expression from the studio days. The best music is never recorded.
Well, that's true also in concert performance. Best rendering of whatever you're going to perform in a concert, you probably has done in rehearsal or a sound check.
Run-throughs in a studio.
Yeah.
You get a bunch of cracker jacks in there running the stuff down. You see those same faces. You know, regardless how stupid it is, it's going to take on its elegance until the producers start to shut it down if it's a project.
Yeah, right.
If that makes any sense.
Well, it makes total sense. But for the younger people who are watching who may not have lived through any of the studio work or known about jingles and stuff that is not great music, but you do to make a living, it may not connect. But...
Once in a while, you'll get a Michel Legrand or something, some charts by Billy Byers. You'll get something, or those old Fletcher Henderson charts of Benny Goodman's when I got to play for Benny. Yeah. I mean, there's so much. And Louis Belson with his Tommy Newsom's charts were delicious. Yeah. I mean, his suite that he wrote for Louis is, I mean, it's gorgeous. I mean, the stuff that he, there's so much good stuff. So there are these rewards that we get in what we have to sit down and play and pour it on, so to speak.
Right. What? Just a little anecdote before we get back to your earlier career. When I was studying with Joe Allen as a young player, I was still in my teens, and I remember him saying, "Ed, if 10% of the music you're going to play to earn a living is going to be artistic, then you've done very well."
Yes, this is true.
Yeah.
But meanwhile, you take it to that place. Regardless, if you took the gig and you're in there. And I used to make the guys mad because I was always like very religious about the music, you know, from a young kid. And we would be having to go to another jingle because it was so darn busy at that time.
Right.
And there was an experiment, we're double parked, you know, we got to get, no, we almost got it. Let's do another take and give them their worth, give them the music that's supposed to be there. Once we figured it out, because sometimes there are these ramifications unnecessary, sometimes necessary. You go through them with the production behind the glass,
right,
and they're hearing it a different way than you're playing it. So once you get on track with that, it might take a minute or two because, you know, getting the ego out of the way is a very important thing with playing music. You have to be selfless. You have to get out of the way and just let it happen. And whatever those presets are that are sort of locked in, it's almost like a legal thing, that glass thing where they're on the other side of the glass telling you how to play because they can't do it, but they think they can hear the way it's supposed to go. Once you've gotten into their head and the time runs out, what do? Do you run out on it? No, you finish. You stay and you finish it. And you walk out of there proudly, knowing you did the best you could with what you had to do it with, you know.
Right.
With the mentality of the, I'm not going to use any bad words, but you know what I mean.
Yeah. Well, that's
almost an angry, it almost becomes a confrontation.
Right. Well, that you're speaking to the professionalism and the respect one has for music and themselves and
the job.
And the discipline.
Yes.
You know, the discipline. Well, yeah, it's that. But let's go back now. I know you, as a young player, studied with Carl Waxman, who was a formidable musician in New York and Philly and someone who had a huge career. I know he led and played lead alto for Lester Lannan for decades. But he also played for several decades with the Philly Orchestra playing their sax solos.
Yes, he did.
So this was a very well-versed musician. How did you come to Carl Waxman?
Well, I was studying clarinet with Pete. Oh, golly, his name, it escapes me. Pete, not Lanuti, was my oboe teacher. Pete Lanuti, it was. Anyway, when he heard me play the saxophone, he suggested Carl. He says, you got to go to Carl. So I went over to Carl, and he was, oh golly, was he strict. Oh, first of all, he made me go last. I had to sit through all of his students and sit there and watch him teach these other students.
Wow. Now, did the other students have to do that similarly, or was that just for you?
No, that was just for me. This didn't happen right away, but it eventually took place.
And how old were you roughly at this time, roughly?
9 years old.
Wow, that's very, you were playing clarinet and now saxophone by nine. Yeah. That's very young, George.
And then when I was 10, the oboe, I got into the oboe.
Jeez. Well, now, just to play, to be big enough to play the alto or the clarinet, to have your fingers. I mean, were you a bigger kid? I mean, just, I'm trying to imagine holding a clarinet even at 7 or 8 years old. That's a full-size clarinet. That's pretty, that's to cover all the holes, and you were able to do that.
Everything.
Wow.
Sloppy though. I was very sloppy because of that, you know. Yeah. But then with Carl, as I was studying with, his name will come to me. I would be taught one way of playing from him, and then I go to Carl, and Carl was a whole. Well, so I was learning two different methods of playing.
You mean as far as embouchure and use of the breath and the tone?
I had to change everything with Carl.
Wow.
Yeah. I was into the Closé book at that point, and the Trexler, the Rosé book, the Trexler book for saxophone. Carl was very, very strict. He was far more strict than my clarinet teacher was. And later in life, when he started to hire me as an adult, now I'm 20 years old, so time has passed and I have become a professional player. I'm playing all over the world with my group. And then I go in, I'm making a transition from the saloon business and the concertizing with my group to becoming a studio player, because my first hit was Bobby Rondell's Kissin' Time.
Ah, yes.
That was my first tenor solo. And then the second one was Chubby's Let's Twist Again. And then, of course, it went on from there to the Dovells, I Can't Sit Down, You Can't Sit Down, Lightning Strikes Again, Vicky Sue Robinson's Turn the Beat Around. I had so many hit records that I played on. And but when Carl hired me, Mr. Waxman, I used to call him, when he hired me to play with Lester Lannan in Chicago, I couldn't believe. I said, you really want me to play? Yeah, I want you to play tenor. I want you to play the jazz and the rock. I want you to play the tenor chair, first tenor. I said, okay. Well, I was like scuffling. I was going between gigs, you know, New York, running up. At this point, I'm running up to New York to do the Four Seasons, to do the Shirley Ellis Name Game, to do the McCoys. I mean, so many hits now are going on.
And this is in the early 60s.
This is in the late 60s.
Late 60s. Okay.
At this point, mid to late 60s.
Okay.
And I'm trying to cut loose the saloon business, as I call it, because I need to practice. I'm going into deeper water now, and I'm not just going to go up on stage with no paper in front of me. So I have to get my books out again. I have to start reading. I have to get into classical music. Got to start playing cool out flute duets with my flute buddy from Billy Root. He's getting ready to go to Vegas. He's a great jazz player, Billy Root. I don't know if you know.
Well, I absolutely know of him through Ronnie Rubin. And of course, yeah. I've heard him with Stan Kenton. And
brilliant.
Yeah, fantastic, great natural jazz feel, lines, everything.
We groomed each other. He was studying with Murray Panitz on flute. I was studying with Harold Bennett. And we shared our differences. And we were playing flute duets, we were playing clarinet duets. And, you know, we really got into more intellectual music than just the jazzness of it, you know.
Right.
And then also I got into the jazz thing as well. You know, I was starting to listen more to Charles Parker and to Benny Carter and the fellow you mentioned earlier, Rabbit, his nickname was.
So. Yeah. Johnny Hodges. Right.
Yeah, I fell in love with Johnny, man, and Benny Carter.
What was your practice routine like? Was there anything that you could share that might be unique or might point us, all of us who were trying to develop that still, trying to find out how you had that type of magnificent control and expression on the saxophone?
Well, it started out playing under very loud, thick circumstances. I had an organ, I had a guitar, I had electric bass, and I had a drummer. And the thickness underneath, sometimes for me to get through it, I'd have to jump up an octave in order to put my point across. And then it worked. It was all in the presentation. All right, now it's time for me to present something to play. How am I going to do this in the crowd? No, I had to step above it. So that's where the altissimo, I started to grow beyond the F sharp and the G, and the G sharp was a very challenging.
So it wasn't necessarily that someone specifically pointed you that way. It was your decision, your recognition of the need to do that.
It was the need to do that.
And then I have to ask you this as well, because I've never heard anyone play that part of the saxophone with such command and in tune. I mean, I'm sitting here and I, you know, work at this pretty religiously too. It's really quite astonishing to hear how well you play that register and all on all of the saxophones and so in tune. So, again, was there anything other than your natural gift and your talent and your hard work that led you to being able to play that part of the horn so well with such command and with beauty? I mean, it really sounds like a violin so much of the time.
Well, it was just, you know, I don't really know how to answer that question. It was where I needed to go. And there was a time where I was really down on myself because the bottom of the horn was suffering. When I got to the tenor in New York, it was Chet Amsterdam that came over to me and he said, George, when are you going to stop playing that tenor like an alto and play it like a tenor? What about the bottom of the instrument? It's a gorgeous part. And it opened up my head, not for the altissimo aspect of it,
right,
but for the actual hardy, gorgeous foundation of that instrument on the bottom, starting with the B flat, you know, and
right
up. And he opened my head, you know, it was like he pulled my coat and I thanked him. I said, geez, thanks. You're making me aware of something. Here I'm lost in the clouds.
Yeah.
So it's just something that when you're playing seven nights a week in Wildwood, New Jersey, and two matinees, and you have a repertoire that calls for those notes, and you're playing them every day, many times. It's a form of repetitive. I mean, this is the principle of relentless pressure. That's where the grooming took place for me. And that was my practice.
I see.
I wasn't there to practice. I was there to play music. But listening to what I'm doing, trying to really lock them in, you know,
right,
and sing and just forget about me and just get into what are we doing here? We're playing for these people. So it's all about the presentation.
As we talked a little bit before our interview, a little known fact for most of us who have followed you and your career is that you were actually admitted to Curtis, the Curtis School of Music, on clarinet, and which is quite an accomplishment, as you and I discussed earlier, because for those who are unaware, Curtis, I think still to this day, but certainly in the 1950s, would only have four people on any one woodwind instrument. So if one person graduated in any one year, you might have one opening, maybe two openings in a year. But it was quite an accomplishment, because Curtis in those days was clearly the number one orchestral training school in this country. We have many now that have really upped their game, but there was no question that if you were admitted to Curtis, you were considered one of the four best, let's say, in clarinet, the four best clarinetists of your generation, of your age level. There was not a question about that. So you must have really, really had some wonderful ability and facility on clarinet at a young age, as well as the saxophone.
Well, I played, there was a time when I played in the Germantown Youth Orchestra, clarinet. I played in, junior high school, or not even yet, they took me out of grammar school and they put me in the junior high school all-city orchestra and concert band on clarinet.
Was that for that was for high school kids, right?
Of junior high school.
Junior high school kids, okay.
So I'm now in junior high school playing in the clarinet section, in the concert band and in the orchestra.
Right.
There were two. So that's three. And then it became a little more overwhelming, because as I got into junior high school, they added the senior high school orchestra, all city and concert band. So here I am playing all of this classical music. And some of the stuff was very challenging, you know? But we had good directors, and they knew how to teach us how to learn these things. And we'd take the parts home and we would work on them. And that was a very busy time in my life, where those formative years between the ages of 10 through when I graduated 17. So yes, I was already being groomed, and Mr. Heilicke was so disappointed when I told him I was going to go to Vegas, Reno, and Tahoe.
Right.
And wait, you band, my band, right. Plus my group, I was playing with my
right.
group weekends.
So, but when in that first semester of the one semester you were at Curtis, the 6 months, who was your teacher then at that time? Who do you remember who you were assigned to?
Giuliani.
Ah, Tony, Anthony Giuliani.
Anthony okay. Giuliani.
Well, wow. So you really were going full steam ahead, at least at that point, as a 17-year-old, you know, on track to have an orchestral career, theoretically. But you also, on the side, had your group and like you told me earlier today, the call of gigging and having some exposure and all that was too much to turn down.
Well, I was very loyal to my band members. I mean, we all grew up together. In fact, my drummer, we're the only two that are still around. Pete Cozy, he's still my favorite drummer. I keep telling him that. He says that I'm lying. But we're good. We're so close. Pete is a real keeper, man. I love this guy. And we started out when we were 12 years old with
wow.
a trio. It was the Bach Trio. It has nothing to do with Bach. It was Bender, Opalisky, and
I see. Okay.
The initials of our last names.
Right.
The Bach Trio, and then later became the Rockenbachs. And then later on became the Review, the George Young Review. And that's the one that did the Ed Sullivan Show.
We've had a lot of great horn players on our show, but we're going to open up the show this evening with a review. It's the George Young Review, and just wait until you hear his saxophone. Let's have a fine hand for the George Young Review out of Philadelphia. Let's hear it.
when you're smiling. The whole world smiles with you. When you're laughing, keep on laughing. The sun comes shining through.
Here in New York this week, and we'll be there for your opening. You're just fine. Let's have a wonderful hand for another young guy.
Philadelphia has a tremendous tradition of great musicians in all styles of music. So in growing up, I mean, you had the Philadelphia Orchestra in the heyday, magnificent Philadelphia Orchestra with legends on every woodwind chair.
Yes.
You also had some of the greatest jazz musicians and some of the early rock and roll R&B players there. I mean, you had all these influences around you. Can you speak to any individuals besides your teachers, perhaps players, during those formative years who really made an impression on you and may have pushed you in certain directions?
Yes, Buddy Savitt. Buddy Savitt was a mentor of mine.
I see.
Not formally mentioned, but as I look back, he influenced me greatly playing on his second tenor with his glissandos in the right places and his inflections, his the way he would phrase.
Right.
And I was very impressed with it. And I always listener that I am, I would take on whatever he's doing and sort of glorify it to a point where, all right, if that's where we're going to go with this thing, let's go do it together. And my ability to play with others grew from that point on, where when you're playing, you have to encompass all. You don't just think about yourself and listen to yourself. How am I positioned in my sax section?
Right.
Is my signal, is it too loud, too soft? Am I sharp or am I flat? You have to check out all these ingredients before you proceed into doing the music aspect of it.
Right.
And
right.
In listening like that so acutely, you pick up things like Bernie Glow, for example, in New York.
Yes.
Charles Colello came over to me one time and said, Georgie, how come you don't phrase the horns for me anymore? Because I went in like I was Buddy Savitt. Right. And I would just say, here's where it is, because we'd be doing a rock and roll song. But I heard something. I told Charlie Colo, I said, you know, Charlie, I heard Bernie. Bernie's got a better idea. So I'm going to go with Bernie.
And just to intervene, for those who may not know, Bernie Glow is one of the greatest trumpet players, esteemed, beloved by colleagues, and the most beautiful sound, and I guess you'd have to say clearly a legend.
Oh, you know, I mean, there isn't a word or a compliment high enough that I can bestow on Bernie. Bernie was, he was tops. He was at the top of what I was hearing. I mean, there's a guy going at 9 o'clock in the morning and play classical music, you know? I mean, play a very delicate passage on the trumpet and make it sound like that flower I was mentioning earlier.
Yeah.
I mean, and that's the real artistry and the beauty that you learn from when you pay attention and you're listening to it and you go, oh my gosh, listen to that. Wow, I wish I could sound like that.
Yeah. Well, now let's just jump ahead a little bit. Coming to New York and getting into the studios, I mean, it, you know, people read about these things and hear about them, but it's not that easy. How did you sort of make your entree into the New York studio scene? What led to that and how did that evolve?
Well, when I got to New York, I would try to play with every opportunity. That's where I met Lawrence, playing at one of those rehearsal places down in the basement on 50-something street. I forget what it is.
Oh, maybe was it the Colin Studio rehearsal?
Yes, thank you, yes.
Yes, I remember that place.
Yeah, going in there, waiting your turn to play with the big band in there. It goes through these parts. Gene Roland's arrangements.
Right.
And I mean, oh my God. And... And that's where I met Lawrence, who I love. I really love Lawrence. Lawrence is, there's a talk about a talent that's ultimately on top of his game.
Yeah.
With his instrument. I mean,
yeah, he's a passionate music lover and student of the discipline for sure.
Yes. But that's, that I would go in there and I would, and then when I started doing dates, I would bump into the other tenor player or the other baritone player, Joe Farrell, who was just off the road. And Joe would say to me, Georgie, and he would giggle. He had this giggle. He would say, push in and play faster, he would say to me. And when I'd get to Philadelphia, Harold Carabell, I'm doing a Broadway show in Philly at the same time. I'm running back and forth like a roadrunner, and Harold Carabell would say to me, Georgie, will you pull out and play slower? You're playing like those New York guys, man. So I figured that my pitch and my time were somewhere around exit 12 on the dirt bike.
that's cute.
Hysterical.
Well, but I think what you alluded to is the idea that you have to be willing to put yourself out there and do any gig, whether it's paying or not, a freebie, and just to play music and meet people. And you know, ultimately, if you're deserving, things will eventually turn your way.
And you help. You go there. If something's missing and you find it, you fix it. Like one time I'm sitting next to Romeo, who was another one of my mentors, Romeo Penque.
Yes.
And Romeo's playing, he's playing the, I don't remember what part it was, but there was a wrong note at the copyist. And I picked up on it and I told Romeo, ever so delicately, I said, Romeo, I think that's a B natural on that chord. And he was so enamored with the fact that I was helping, and he gave me such a high compliment, which I felt I didn't deserve, but he was a wonderful he he brought the love to the situation. He one time went in his pocket. He said, try this mouthpiece. We're getting ready to make a take. And I said, well, we're getting ready. Jay, you'll get used to it in 2 minutes, he says, or 2 seconds. I put it on and whoa, you know. He says, see? He says, keep it. That was Romeo Penque.
That's called being a mensch.
Absolutely. And the other one was Phil Bodner. Phil was another one. Oh, my God, how I love those guys, man. I learned so much from them, as well as Joe, as well as Wally Kane.
Yes.
You know, and the list just goes on. There's no one individual. There's something to learn from everyone. And a funny joke, something about time and tempo, like Bill Lavonia, the drummer.
Yes.
I learned more about odd meter music from Billy and playing Greek gigs with Gus Valley. And that whole 7 and 9 and 5 and all 11. And even challenged myself to write music in those odd meters and make them swing, you know, write them in a way that they could swing with a proper bass part and a proper drum part and the way the figures would lend themselves on the paper to the player, you know. Right. But that's where it is. And I also tell all my students, well, I'm thinking of that. Playing is just the tip of the iceberg. The real music is inside. So if you're playing and you just want to improvise a couple notes on your instrument, be it a clarinet or saxophone or a flute or a violin, write them down. Write those 4 notes down. Maybe you have the beginning of a little piece of music of an original. Take it somewhere. You know, there's only 12 notes, so you can stretch it. You can get an octave. I used to have kids write for their lesson. I used to have them take their telephone number and at 120, and each number would indicate a pitch.
Right.
0 could either be a wild card or a rest. But don't forget the rest, because there has to be space in composition.
Can you talk to the, I know equipment is always a thing on woodwind players' minds, especially doublers, and it's something that's always changing. But generally, could you talk to maybe the middle of the road, the setup that you would remember yourself playing most, let's say in the 70s and the 80s? In general, what would you play, an alto, tenor, soprano, clarinet? And what was your flute of choice?
Well, my flute of choice was the one that Harold got for me. And then later, I went from the Harold Bennett head joint to the Lou DeVoe.
Okay.
He was a great loss. Lou was another wonderful gentleman up at Haynes.
Right. And so you were playing Haynes flutes pretty much throughout your career? Yes,
totally. And I played, I bought Romeo's, it was a Japanese model.
Marimatsu?
Marimatsu flute, silver.
Right.
Beautiful flute from him. And right. I played on metal Haynes piccolo.
Yes.
With a winged embouchure plate.
Right.
Which I purchased from, this wonderful flautist. Oh, what a doubler he was. Anyway, I bought that from him, and then I purchased from DeVoe, I got a wooden Haynes piccolo.
Okay.
When I was touring with Liza, I had a lot of piccolo to play.
Right.
And one time I was practicing my piccolo in my office in New York on 57th Street above the Russian Tea Room. Billy Byers, there was the little Carnegie Theater.
Right. The recital hall.
Excuse me?
Was that the recital hall?
No, the little Carnegie Realty, excuse me.
Oh, okay.
Little Carnegie above Russian Tea Room was this building, this old decrepit building, where several musicians, Dick Kleiman was my neighbor in the back. And this one morning, it's like 5 o'clock in the morning and I'm practicing piccolo because I have a date coming up and I want to really, you know, get the weeds out of the piccolo, if you know. And I'm going through my exercises, having fun with them. All of a sudden, my neighbor on the organ, I hear the same exercise, whatever I was doing, the gibberish. Nick Hyman is playing the very same thing on his organ through the wall. And we both, at the same time, went out in the hallway and looked at each other and started crying with laughter. It was the most, one of the most wonderful moments of my practicing life.
Yeah.
Well, what a memory.
That's a nice memory.
Oh, he was wonderful.
Yeah. And all right, so the flutes, you're playing Haynes pretty much for your career, with the exception of that flute that Romeo gifted you. And saxophones, you're a Selmer guy, I think, pretty much up until
recently. Most of the time was all Selmer.
Right.
All Selmer until the 80s when I was going to Japan for the first time. And Steve Gadd said, look, I'll make sure I get you up to Yamaha because you might enjoy that and you might find something interesting there. So I went out and purchased. I went over to Giardinelli's and Jack Onque was working there. And I purchased a Yamaha 62 soprano. I had a Selmer, but I took that with me. And I got to meet all the people at Yamaha where their plant is. And it was very interesting the way they were. A very meticulous thing. I love how they care so much, you know. I really do. It's been a wonderful ride for me. I've been so blessed, Ed. It's ridiculous.
Well, but you've also, but that also comes with the work you put in and the artistry that you have shared for generations now, George. And that, I mean, you know, it sort of comes back in a circle all the time. But you have created a quantity of work. A body of work that really still to this day guys talk about it. And I wanted to mention something that not only Lawrence Feldman, but Roger Rosenberg has told me in just talking in general, not even about, in preparation for this interview, that you were one of the few guys who would always welcome younger players, people who were just getting into let's say the higher level of work in New York, the higher level, the better level of work and studio work, that you were always accommodating, encouraging, would put them on, you know, gigs to cover you if you couldn't make it. That is not the typical situation. That is not what most of us found. But you were one of the few people who would do that and with no hesitation about hiring anyone if you felt they were deserving. And that's a little bit of what you imparted Romeo and Phil Bodner represented to you. So, you know, it's wonderful to hear that, but also for you to recognize that others feel that way about you.
Well, you know, I feel it was always the right thing. You know, when you get so busy that, you know, you're trying to adjust your schedule. And it was really the heyday of studio playing and studio work, that every time a key person to help was Lou Soloff. Lou, once he got involved with staying in New York after his Blood, Sweat, and Tears situation, and he concentrated mostly on his jazz playing, he would always know who's who, who's coming into town. And he told me about Lou Marini. He told me about Jerry Nywood. I mean, the list, and then Alex Foster was coming up from Philly, and they needed an alto player for the Saturday Night Live show back in the 80s. And I would do it, you know, with the big band every time they would augment the group,
right,
going back to the Belushi days, you know. But I recommended Alex. They were squawking about ethnicity and stuff like that. So I said, call Alex. Alex can do it, because I had already used him or suggested him, right, on dates, right, and rehearsals that I was unable to do. And I always got thank yous and, you know, kudos on the, especially his clarinet playing was.
Right, he was a very high level clarinet player.
Yes. So with that in mind, and then Marini came in one time when I had to run on a Miller date, and I had met him for the first time because of Lou's high recommendation, I had him sit down and finish the date. And that was how I met Lou Marini, just on the word of Lou Soloff saying, Marini can do it, and he sure could. And the rest is history.
Sure. Well,
Jerry Nywood, unfortunately, who we lost, but there was another brilliant player of our instruments.
Yeah. Well, but you know, that's what it should be, and that's what you you certainly grow up thinking it's going to be like. But then when you enter the business, you realize that it's rare. It's
it doesn't
rare.
Work like that. Under normal circumstances, it's abnormal.
Right. That unfortunately, but still, it speaks well to you and your way you looked at your place in the industry, and also how you treated the profession.
It's also, you know, getting out of the way, as I mentioned earlier, and having your chief reason for being as a helper, and always thinking about the music and how can we make it better. Sometimes you don't have to. Sometimes it's right there. You play for Michel Legrand. You don't have to touch a thing. Just play the notes and the music will bring you right in. And this is true with a lot of classical music. You mean, if you just listen and pay attention, it'll happen. But you got to get out of the way. You know, you can't overshoot it, or you'll miss. You won't put the putt in. You know what I mean? You
can't. Yep. No, I know exactly what you mean. And
there's a time to be bold.
Right.
There's a time to set a precedent for the lead. If you're playing lead out, though, you want to lead. But once you get your gathering, cool it. Let the section do the work. Right. I mean, you're splitting hairs, but to listen to that degree is how important it is.
Right. Yes. And no question. If you were to give advice to young players today who were looking for careers as multiple woodwind players, do you generally, many people believe, I'm actually one of them, that starting on clarinet is a benefit in going forward on saxophone and flute, and even if one wants to go into the double reeds. Do you believe that to be true or not necessarily?
Absolutely. I do believe that, because there's no better foundation than, like Frank West said, the clarinet was invented by three bats that didn't know each other.
Right.
And he said, one time, he hated the clarinet. He told me, Georgie, we're going to go into Central Park. We're going to have a burning, man. So don't take the clarinet. Let's go to Central Park. We'll put them in a pile and burn them.
But you know the funny thing about Frank West that I found out, that he never admitted that when he was in college, he was a flute major after the war, but that he had played originally, he was a clarinet major at one point.
Yes.
You know, so he we know with his talent, there's no question he would have played beautifully. No question.
Frank, talk about another mentor and the great storyteller on gigs. We would sit around and he would tell these stories and take you there. He actually had a beautiful way of taking you to the situation he was talking about. Marvelous human being. Well, no, I loved him so much. I'm not the only one. We loved Frank, and we were so saddened when we lost him. But hey, look, time runs out, you know? So what you have to do is encourage the youth to do the right thing. And don't play so loud. Don't play so many notes because you have all these keys. That's not where it's at. One note at a time will get you there better. And another thing to mention is when you practice to the point where you feel you can play with others well enough, go out there, reach out to another player that's into the same kind of thing that you are. Play those clarinet duets, saxophone duets, get some Lenny Niehaus saxophone duets, whatever. And then the flute duets, I mean, they're quants. There's a wealth of flute music, clarinet music and stuff for training.
Yes.
For training. And then if you have someone else to play with, you can learn how to do that better. And then there's the trios and the quartets. And it just encourage yourself to grow beyond yourself.
Right.
That's really where it's at.
Absolutely. And in wrapping up our discussion, George, let's tell us what you're doing these days. I know when I spoke to you earlier this week, you said you don't get involved with the internet so much because it takes too much time away from practicing and composing. So that hit me straight between the eyes that you are still geared right down the middle and working on your music, you know, as hard as ever. So can you tell us a little bit about what you're doing out now in California these many years?
Well, I have a quartet who, you know, we haven't played that much because of the pandemic, but I've been putting together a lot of my music as well as the standards that we play, and both songbook, the American songbook, with our stylish way of approaching them, as well as the classic jazz repertoire, and then my original music, and then the pianist is now writing. I'm so happy that I've encouraged him to bring something to the table. And then trying to find the time and adjust that time between composing and practice. And the practicing, it's like, I wish I could do that 100-yard dash like I used to. So that's the one thing, you know, less is more. I learned this from Frank Wess. As he was getting into his elder years, he sort of like honored the space more instead of being the note pusher that he was always capable of being. I mean, we're all there. We got these buttons on these instruments or these on the clarinets or flute. But the thing is, melodies are good, you know, telling a story, you know, improvising doesn't have to be, look what I can do all the time. Sometimes it erupts to that. Like when I would do those concerts in Japan and the music would, you know, start kicking me in the butt to do something, then I would have to really push the envelope to a degree where it became quite challenging. But just to go there, I was well conditioned to do it, and I managed to get through it, and I was very happy and felt blessed at the end of an exhausting concert, because the Japanese, their demands. No ballads. Everything has to be, you know, macho, you know, cigarettes and machoism.
Right.
That the philosophy over there with music in the jazz theater is, unless you're a big name and you don't kowtow to their demands, it's seldom you can play it. I got to play New York State of Mind one time, and the producer over there who Kawashima said, George San, you made me cry. I said, well, you know, we have to do more ballads. You know, people like ballads too, I told him.
Right.
There's nothing wrong with the melody and giving your heart to the people, you know?
In the heyday of the studio period, your studio work, describe, let's say, a typical week, what it might be. Let's say maybe during the period of time when you're doing Saturday Night Live as a regular, what would the normal week be like for you, you know, in a general way, Monday through Sunday? What, it's just to give the younger players an idea of how much work and what the demands were on people who were in your position.
Well, we'd start out usually on a Monday, anywhere 10 a.m., that's when the jingles would start. Sometimes, very seldom, but 9 o'clock would be a call. But the majority of the starting days was 10 o'clock. And they would book it with a possible 20 or a possible 40, depending upon if it's a campaign, if they're doing a campaign for one of the big.
Right. Okay. And just for the younger players, when they say possible 20 or possible 40, meaning that the player had to allow a possible extra 20 minutes beyond the scheduled time or 40 minutes beyond the time you were booked for in case the session ran over.
Correct. Correct. And that held for both 20s and 40s. And then from that point, you'd be running to another. You'd be running to another. You try to program them in a way, or schedule them in a way that you would have enough time to get there on time and get set up with the next instruments that you had to play. And usually you would be carrying them around with you.
Right.
And then mid-afternoon, you usually would start your record sessions, your recording, where you're doing phonograph records. And that would go into the evening, 7 to 10. Sometimes it would go beyond. And then this was a daily formula way that the people in the industry would call in their sessions. The jingle, sometimes in the afternoon, you get a jingle date in the afternoon, or maybe very seldom in the evening, because you couldn't get the best players in the evening. They'd be on record dates doing something.
Right. And just, again, this is the era before cell phones. And so for the younger players, there was generally a central service called Radio Registry.
Correct.
That people who needed musicians would call into and would request a musician, or would have the registry contact musicians and tell them where the recording was going to happen, at what time, and what instruments to bring. It was a completely different world than we are in today.
Yes. In each studio, the popular studios would have a phone there that was a direct line to Radio Registry. And when you walk out, getting ready to leave the date, there would be a bulletin board with call Radio Registry, George on call Radio. And that's where Lawrence was like a savior for me, because God bless Lawrence Feldman, man. Of all the subs that I've ever had, he was the best one for me.
Right.
He knew how to get on my corner. You know, it was hysterical. I mean, the way he could copy what he thought would be the way I approach a date.
Right.
And I never thank him enough for that.
He does have that wonderful ability to emulate styles, and he loves doing that, and he still does. So
yes.
So I'm sure he'll be happy to hear you say that.
He's a mensch.
Yes. Yes, he is. I'm a sugar to mensch.
Well, you know, the maid, who's, I have to tell you about one guy who's an unsung hero, is Danny Bank.
Oh,
I learned more from Danny Bank about the clarinet, the saxophone, and the flute, piccolo, you name it, bass, clarinet, the list goes on. He had more inside scoop on the woodwind doubling
Yes.
than than anyone, more than any of the other people who I loved, like Romeo and Phil, and it was Danny who had, and Beckenstein, Ray Beckenstein is another one.
Yes.
I have to thank Ray and Don Hammond was the gentleman I bought the piccolo from.
Oh yeah, he was a wonderful composer too, a wonderful flute and piccolo player. That, I mean, top level doubler.
Yes.
I just want to get back to the last thing we talked about, your schedule. You're basically saying you had easily 2 to 3 services a day during those heydays.
Sometimes more.
Yeah.
Sometimes more, because if I had to do a solo, like one time Quincy Jones, I was there, Lawrence was with me. We ran down to A&R and I had to do a solo on a track, Stuff Like That.
Stuff Like That on alto, yes.
Which I had my pea shooter, and I had a Bobby Dukoff, No. 7 Star, which was, you talk about mouthpieces and equipment. This seemed to work, and it was the mouthpiece of choice for maybe a decade or
yes,
part of a decade.
And Sanborn helped popularize that.
Well, he wasn't playing on that mouthpiece. He was playing on a level air.
Oh, the Brillhart level air.
Yes.
Ah.
Not the Bobby Dukoff. We used to call them Duke booties because we hated them.
Yeah.
You know, the purists hated them.
Again, for the younger players or people who aren't as equipment, there are old Bobby Dukoff mouthpieces from the 50s that were completely different. Another
wonderful
world.
Wonderful mouthpieces.
Brass Dukoffs that were just phenomenal.
But the equipment, but the material that they made, the latter ones, was very porous.
Right.
So I went to Pepe's. The brass,
yeah, the brass guy. You
know, we used to work on the brass instruments, yeah, for the trumpeters and the trombones and those guys. And Joe Shepley was the one that said, go to Pepe and he'll play it for you.
Right.
Seal it up.
Right.
And that made it magic. That did the trick.
Huh. Interesting.
The George Marge, all the cats, man, next thing you see in their kit, they have their gold Dukoff.
Four in the morning, I'm tapped out, yawning, longing my life away. I'll never worry, why should I? When it's all gonna fade. Thank you. Now I sit by my window and I watch the cars roll by. I fear I'll do some damage one fine day, but I would not be convicted by a jury of my peers. Still crazy after all these years. Well, still crazy. Still crazy. George Young, Philadelphia boy, George Young.
One time, I almost made George Marge cry. How important it was for George we nicknamed him Dates.
Yes.
Herb Buschler nicknamed him Dates, right?
Yes.
And one time I had like 23 or 24 dates because I had to work on a Saturday. And when I was astounded that I had done that many dates. And I was going through my book and I was sitting with George. We were on a date. And he was, man, he was so disappointed.
That's very...
I think he did 20 because he was doing everything. I mean, you know, right. Flute, clarinet, saxophone, flutes, clarinets, saxophones, oboes, recorders,
right?
I mean, you name it, soup to nuts. This guy, he never turned anything down. Very, very talented, driven, hardworking guy.
Yeah,
sounded wonderful on everything, you know. Maybe dated on certain things, as you know, for. The things that you're hearing, he wasn't hearing what, say, I was hearing out of the saxophone.
Right.
Or the clarinet, for that matter. With, you know, see, the thing is, don't let the instrument do all the work. Don't hook up to the instrument. You're the instrument. The player is the instrument. You have to use everything from your tummy and the entire, you know, your chest cavity, your neck, your throat, your oral cavity. It all plays a part in nurturing the sound that you want to present for your presentation. You're the instrument. And the instrument is like a prop, basically. It's your bugle. It's your way of saying something. But you're talking from your body with the music, if that makes any sense.
It totally makes sense. And of course, I wish I had known about this when I was in my 20s and 30s, when I was buying every possible mouthpiece, every possible ligature. Not that I still don't check out equipment, which I must admit, but as you get older, I certainly have realized it's what you're hearing and what's in your head. And whether you're playing a Dukoff or a Brillhart, you know, a white old Brillhart, like you were playing that night I heard you and Eric's, during the period of the 80s, when you were also playing Dukoffs and when you're doing Saturday Night Live and all different types of music, how does one do that with equipment that seems to be so completely different? It's because the music is strong in your mind and your ears and your body.
And you adapt. You adapt to
yes,
it.
Yes.
Because you want to hear it a certain way. See?
Right.
Getting back to that, being very fussy. You want to hear, I got to make this sound beautiful somehow. It's an ugly piece, but so you take your training to that level. You take it through that filter, that connection
right.
to the instrument that's going to enable you to do that gorgeous fortissimo, you know, so that it's bold and it's beautiful because it's fitting on a noisy track. Oh my gosh, listen to that, you know, but, that's not saying you're going to, that's not home plate, but if it's going to get the gig done, if it's going to make the music happy, that's what we're supposed to be doing.
Right.
Make the music happy. It's all about the music. We, we just have to figure ways to make the music gorgeous or exciting. It has, music has so many personalities, sadness. It has, you know, it's like we have to figure out a way to make the minor key smile. You know, it's Lawrence likes that expression. You know, there's so many expressions that have popped up over the...
And we don't have to play the harmonic minor to do that.
No. It's just the way it is. It's there. We just have to go reach for it. And reach for it sincerely and lovingly.
Yeah. Well, George, it's been such a pleasure to speak with you. And, you know, I hope the many people who will watch this, and especially younger players, will take to heart so many of the things you've said and shared with us from someone who's lived through the heyday of the music era, playing every possible style of music. And hopefully, you know, during the course of this interview, we'll have tracks from different periods of your career. And hopefully everyone will understand now more about what you were about and what you are about. And we look forward to hearing more of your releases. There's a ton of CDs on your website that are available, and we hope people will jump to the site, not only to watch you playing on the videos that you've offered, but to purchase some of these wonderful CDs. And again, thanks so much. And, you know, we'll talk a little bit right after the interview, if you hang on a little bit. But anyway.
Okay, but if there's one more thing I wanted to just is, you know, chameleons have a way of changing when necessary. And in a way, a good musician adopts that same kind of, as you're moving from one style of music to another, that's what the studio has trained a lot of us to do, to be like chameleons. You know, it's like when in Rome kind of a thing.
Yeah, right.
So I just wanted to share that last item of thought. And I'm here anytime, Ed. Anytime you want to talk about music, count me in.
You bet, and I'm going to take up on that, but hang out after we finish, okay, for a second or two. But anyway, thank you again, and stay well, and hopefully we'll see you, you know, back on the East Coast as things hopefully will ease up with the pandemic later this year.
I hope so. Thank you.